Welcome to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good evening or good morning, depending on, of course, upon your time zone. Welcome to another edition of Coast to Coast AM live talk radio throughout the nighttime on the CBC radio network. I'm Art Bell. And I told you I was working on something, and I've got a surprise coming up for you in just a moment. Affiliate number 130 is going to be WCSS-AM in Amsterdam, New York. Yet another New York affiliate, so those of you with relatives in New York might want to let them know in the Amsterdam area that we're on the way. Huh. I did tell you there was going to be a surprise this morning, didn't I? Or did I not mention it? There is something about prophecy, predictions, and the next millennium that has every one of us on the edge of our seats, whether it's Nostradamus predicting the rise and fall of Hitler, Old Testament prophets foretelling the coming of Christ, a psychic reading your tarot cards, or the weather woman predicting the rain, there is something in all of us that's helplessly enthralled and terrified about the future, and yet left begging inevitably for more. Witness the overwhelming popularity of NBC's Ancient Prophecies coming up again this Friday night. It was a two-hour special which first aired in March. Then, in a very unusual move, testament to the popularity, it was re-aired just 6 weeks later because of a popular outcry. As a result, actually, of the absolutely overwhelming a number of calls that NBC had praising the special and wanting more. Inevitably, people want more. Well, what a surprise for you. John Hoag, a scholar featured in Ancient Prophecies, and a noted expert on Nostradamus, has compiled hundreds of known prophecies and predictions in his latest book, the Millennium Book of Prophecy, 777 Visions and Predictions. In a book that physically embodies the future, Hoag has created an astonishing and fascinating encyclopedic handbook of hundreds of visionaries across history and across many cultures. John Hoag is the world's leading authority on Nostradamus and other prophetic trends and traditions. He is the author of Nostradamus and the Millennium, which has been published in 9 languages and sold more than 600,000 copies worldwide. As we swiftly approach the year 2000, people are thinking and talking about the next millennium in human history. Will it herald a brave new world or the fiery apocalypse? Coming up in just a moment will be the man who will be featured on Ancient Prophecies this coming Friday evening as our guest this morning. His name is John Hoag. Stay right where you are.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
And now, up to, I believe, the Seattle area and my guest, John Hoag. Hi, John.
Hi, Art.
Welcome to the program.
It's great to be here.
You're quite a catch, and I want to thank Virginia at Ancient Prophecies for helping me get you.
Yes, I want to thank her, too. This will be fun.
John, I guess you're an old hand at radio. You know about radio. The first question I guess I want to ask you is, can we really know the future?
Well, it is difficult to know something that has not happened yet.
That's right.
But what we could probably get a sense of is what directions we are going, that the directions that are being born in this present moment. And that, I think, is, in my work of 20 years of scholarship on prophecy, I'd like to kind of get the focus back to the present. So much prophecy scholarship makes one obsess on the future, rather than reflect on what we're doing in the present to make that future.
Yes.
I am a firm believer, after 20 years of studying the world's different prophetic traditions, above their particular, or hopefully beyond their particular religious biases and expectations, what I gather is that there is indeed quantum futures. Many different ways we can go down certain roads by collective decisions. Well, for instance, like we go down a different road now since Tuesday of last week.
I'll say.
And that is going to open up a whole bunch of quantum futures that would not have happened if the Democrats had done better.
So then how, John, should we think of prophecy? Is it, when it's catastrophic, simply should be regarded as, say, a warning?
I think in the most positive way to use the most pessimistic prophecies is as a warning. Certainly you have the 16th century prophet Nostradamus calling his own prophecies my threats. And
my threats.
Yes.
Is that really what he called them?
Yes, in French, in old French, it's literally my threats.
I see.
And the message behind the mystical crypticness of that is that the point of making a threat is not to have it come true. It's to actually wake up and say, oh, well, I don't want that to happen. I'm going to make you wrong, Mr. Nostradamus.
Well, John, Tuesday accepted. If you look at the social trends in America with regard to crime and people driving babies into lakes and all the rest of that sort of thing, there are times when I'm not very encouraged about the future. Tuesday was encouraging to me, but that came from sort of culmination of frustration, even anger.
Mm.
And if you look at the social line as it progresses, I think it's more in the down direction than the up direction. I guess I'm a pessimist in this area. How do you feel about it?
Well, there is a collective vision from many different times and many different religious and prophetic disciplines which indicate that we are in for about 30 years of chaos. But out of those 30 years of chaos, to steal a quote from Nietzsche, stars will be born. And one of those stars will be an entirely new way of looking at politics, an entirely new way of looking at religion. The move from a nation state point of view to a global state point of view.
Mm-hmm.
These are unstoppable. The reaction, in short, what I'm saying in one word is change is coming. And we all have, on collective and individual levels, ways to react or respond to that change. Some people want to move back to the past.
Yes, they do.
And if one, we can elaborate probably more detail a little later about it, but in predictive astrology, and this is not the astrology of the newspapers, which is like reading three words on the cover of a book and saying you know what astrology is.
Yes.
Astrology has a lot more to do with than that, and one of the fields that I'm involved in is predictive astrology for political movements and what is called mundane or political astrology. And definitely in the next 2-year period, you'll see a very strong desire to move back to the fundamentals of what we know. But after 1996, you see that the energy of the collective, if you will, moving towards the unknown and saying yes to change.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be difficult because we're really doing things we've never done before in our history. And when I started the study of prophecy, I had a passion since I was a little child to study history, and read about 7,000 books of history, the history of the past, in the fascination of the patterns that continually are repeated in the past. Later, around time at the end of high school, I started studying the works of future history, that is, scriptures and of different religions and prophecies, and saw, to my understanding, the same patterns repeating in the future history.
Well, one way, I guess, of deciding with regard to the accuracy of future prophecy would be to look at past prophecy.
Exactly.
And has it been very accurate?
Well, you know, there are tens of thousands of people in our history who have claimed to be soothsayers. It's very difficult to find more than 100 that have a documented track record of prophetic success in the last, thousands of years of known history. And in my book, I have collected roughly 100 prophetic sources that have some very clear documentation of their past successes. They had to be either successful if they had only one prediction, for the prediction had to be at least 75% accurate, or if they had other predictions, a series of predictions, to also have a 75% accuracy rate. Some had even higher than that, but nothing lower than that.
Who was best?
Well, that's a difficult question, because what makes a man like Nostradamus obscure in his prophecies and his culture is the intolerance of the time towards making predictions. If Nostradamus had lived as a Hopi elder, where he didn't have to worry about that and could just speak openly in simple language, he might have an easy acceptance of an Edgar Cayce or a Hopi elder has today, because in those traditions of prophecy, they didn't have to hide it. So it's a difficult question to answer. I would say that, of course, Nostradamus would have to be one of them, simply because the 200 of his over 1,000 prophecies that are clear enough to indicate success are so stunning in their accuracy that they have to be included. And Edgar Cayce for this century is probably one of the most accurate. And surprisingly enough, some of the latter half of the 20th century's more controversial mystics have actually some very accurate predictions concerning our near future.
All right, let me tell you, John, I've been doing this show now for about 9 years, not in syndication that long, but altogether for about 9 years in a row now. And in the last, I'm going to say, 8 months, I've been getting a raft of calls, John, people saying, boy, do I have a feeling of impending doom, or impending occurrence, or impending something. People just calling saying, something really big is going to happen. And I wonder if you've noticed that. I wonder if it's just millennium fever, you know, as we approach the beginning of something new, or the end of this, whatever. Have you noticed that also, a kind of a widespread feeling of something?
I've been watching it build for about 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I've also tried to find correlations in prophetic traditions about it. And there are many, especially in the native peoples of the world. Many of the American Indian seers that I've studied and met tell me that the Earth's energy goes through a cycle of where it increases. In one case, one man from the Yellowknife tribes of northern Canada told me that he believed that a 35% increase in the energy of the world will begin in the 90s and peak in the year 2012. 2012 is also the end of the Mayan calendar, the most accurate calendar of the ancients. A calendar that does not have a loss of a day or a leap day or something for 320,000 years. It's so accurate. Expanding on this theme, there are not only the Christian millennial timekeepers coming to an end of the 1,000 years that always comes in Christian thought, but most of the time cycles of the ancients are all coming to an end and resuming again around this time, and that only happens every 26,000 years. So this is very significant time. The millennial hysteria of the 990s was a very localized experience. The millennial hysteria that we're about to enter will probably not be experienced again in known human history. It's quite significant crossroads at the end of time as we know it.
Could it be the end of time? Is that anybody's prediction?
Well, it is in the book. I have a chapter called "The Crossroad at the End of Time," where the bottom of the page that runs a timeline of all fulfilled prophecies that are dated in the 20th century, and then it goes off into the future millennia. That is one of the hardest disciplines to be good at. There's only a handful of prophets in history who can say, on this day, on this year, this will happen, you know, and say it centuries before it happened. Hmm. This is one of the things Nostradamus was very good at. And so I've listed them, and they're quite dense in the timeline for the first few pages as we go through the 20th century. But after the year 2000, they start to dwindle, and then by 2012, they almost vanish. And then you only have, from the same group, control group of prophets, maybe three or four dated predictions for the next 8 or 9 millennia.
Hmm.
Now,
very worrisome.
Well, it's there's two possibilities. One is that the people of this grand cycle of time who grew up in this energy cannot see beyond this cycle. That's one possibility. And it will be for the people of the new grand cycle of time to make their predictions about the future.
The other, of course, being there is nothing to see.
There's nothing to see because we run into a ditch through our own predictability. And the third possibility is that we find enough people collectively find the answer to what makes them so predictable, and human race becomes a spontaneous, life-affirmative race, and therefore hard to predict.
Do you fancy one over the other?
I think it's a choice that each of us has to see. Which one do we want to have happen, and which one are we going to make efforts in our personal lives to have happen? I know for me the last one is the one I'm working for.
Well, it's very admirable, but again, I go back to my, I suppose, doomsday scenario, and that is that I see a social slide underway, and if I had to predict one of the outcomes you just talked about based on present trends, I don't think I'd be very hopeful.
It is a question I deal with for 2 decades in my own personal life as well. I mean, I've seen about every every angle on doomsday that I think that exists out there in different cultures. I have also, in the first half of this book, arguably, have written the most terrifying scenarios on doomsday. However, I've also, in my work, discovered equal number of prophecies that counterbalance the doomsday, often from the same people, which indicates to me that there is clearly a choice, and that personal responsibility for the future is definitely the hidden message, the key. And of course, it is very scary, and the change is scary. And
John, I've talked to alien abductees. Mm-hmm. I've talked to prophets on this program of various sorts, and almost all of them will say the same thing. This is one possible future. It does not have to be this way. Nevertheless, as I said, when I look at trends, I see it headed the wrong way at the moment. What's the negative side? What's the downside? End scenarios do you see?
Well, now that the dust of the Cold War is off the prophetic crystal ball and we can review the prophecies of Armageddon a second time, one thing I observe is that the Cold War scenario never had much weight. In fact, it was one of the last warnings before Armageddon that Russia and America have become friends, before China and with a Middle Eastern consortium of terrorist nations wage perhaps a war that's not east and west, but the northern nations versus the southern nations.
Mm-hmm.
And this war would be waged over ecological stresses and the breakdown of what are called super systems. That's the sustainability of foods, the sustainability of political structures, of economy. All these things being sorely stressed by having far too many people on the planet, far too much pollution on the planet, and the stress of the way we live our lives. And these are actually the major factors beyond religious and political stresses that will cause World War III. And the two windows for it are between now and 1999, and if it does not happen then, that even if we have all these wonderful treaties with everybody and it seems like we've really passed into the new millennium of peace, if we don't deal right now in the next 10 years with our ecological situations and our sustainability of these super systems, they will break down on us by the 2020s, and you will have the Third World War then. So,
who do you think would be involved?
Well, the scenario will probably depend on how China is introduced into the greater world.
Yes.
And how China deals with that. It's kind of a balance between how China, I mean, Napoleon was, although he's not a prophet in this book, he made some remarkable predictions, and he's the one that made the prediction about the sleeping giant of China. Watch out when, I'm paraphrasing, when that giant awakens, the world will shake, you know. And China will awaken. It is their destiny to become a superpower in the next 10 years and fill the void left by Russia. And
so it may well depend, as China awakens, on China's mood when China wakes up. John, can you hold through the break here?
Sure.
Stand by. We'll be right back to you. John Hogue, the world's a leading expert on Nostradamus. The man who's going to be on Ancient Prophecies this coming Friday will be back in just a moment.
This is Premier Networks. That was Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM on this Somewhere in Time. Somewhere in Time.
My guest is John Hogue. He is none other than the world's leading expert on Nostradamus, on prophets in general, and he'll be back in just a moment. And I know John's listening right now, so I've already got a fax. By the way, if you want to send a faxed question in, you can begin those now. And this is the question. I'll let John think about it as we take care of the commercial continuity here. I purchased John Hogue's 1987 book entitled Nostradamus in the Millennium back in 1988. I'd like to know what revisions the author would incorporate in a new book on the interpretations of Nostradamus' predictions in the 7 years since this book was published. That's from AP in San Diego, and we'll get the answer to all that, AP, in just a moment.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
All right, as we begin this half hour, John, welcome back. Now, to the question with regard to your book and the 7 years since you've written it, would you change anything?
Well, it's an excellent question. In fact, I've been spending the last year rewriting that book, and it is now going to be released as Nostradamus, The New Revelations.
Oh, no kidding.
And it is by Element Books, and it will be distributed by Penguin. And tomorrow I embark on a 5-city tour to introduce this book. And it is something I've wanted to do for these 7 years because about 60% of my original manuscript, which I wrote in 1986 for Nostradamus and the Revelations, was considered basically too hot to handle by the publisher at that time. And since that time, a lot of what I said that didn't get into that book has been more pertinent to the mid-90s than it was in the mid-80s. And so I have reissued all of that.
Give us a little preview. That sounds too good to let go, too hot to handle. What was too hot to handle, and what's in there that we should know about?
Nuclear terrorism as a major threat to a civilian reactor in southwestern Europe around April of 1996 and July of 1999.
Oh, that is hot.
And the fact that some of my astrological interpretations of Nostradamus concerning earthquakes did take place as the Killarney-Latour quake. I said in the first book that October... around October of 93 was a window for a massive earthquake in India, and I was off by one day. It was the night of September 30th, 1993. Unfortunately, I was also accurate about October of 89 being a major earthquake. That was the San Francisco quake.
John, I hit one that I've got to tell you about, and my audience will back me up on this. Do you recall the Japanese earthquake, 8.0 or 8.1 or 2, I forget what it was, gigantic earthquake out in the ocean?
You mean the one last year in, off of Hokkaido?
Yeah, it was just a couple of months ago, a month ago.
Yes, that was the one off the Kuril Islands, yes.
You're not going to believe this, John, but I called that about 8 hours before it occurred, and I did so here on the air. I said, there is going to be a very large earthquake somewhere in the next few hours, or at most couple of days. And I got off the air, you know, at 4 a.m. Pacific time, and went took a little nap. When I woke up, my fax machine was full of faxes saying, my God, we don't believe it. And I really did call that one. And the way I did it, John, was not because it came to me suddenly, but I've learned that we have, when we have sun eruptions, when we have flares, solar flares, we typically have earthquakes. And we were having a massive solar flare that night. And so I stuck my neck out on the air and I said, we're going to have a big, big earthquake in the next few hours. And sure enough, John, there it was.
Well, you know, there's been a lot of ancient study, even in China, about earthquake science concerning not only looking at objective symptoms of things in the cosmos and our local atmosphere, solar system that might influence that, but also in the way animals behave, the way that there seems to be an electromagnetic wave of energy that some sensitive people feel before an earthquake. I know,
yes.
I've had a few experiences of that, and growing up in Southern California, I've weathered a few whoppers like the Sylmar quake. And I know in my own situation, I was once, when I was finishing this book, sitting here in Seattle, it was a sultry summer day, and suddenly I noticed that all the animals and the birds stopped making noises.
That's
and
right.
I kind of got up and went, that's kind of, that we might have an earthquake soon. And then we did, within 3 hours, have a 4.3, which mm-hmm. actually was big enough to shake things.
A lot of the prophets that I've had on this program, John, have talked about incredible earth changes. I've heard things from a massive a meteor or asteroid of some sort hitting in southern Nevada, of all places, thank you very much, to California falling, cracking off and falling off into the ocean with nothing left but islands on up through Washington. I've seen maps that show that. What do your prophets say about that possibility, earth changes?
Well, in my opinion, after studying this, one of the areas that suffers from the most exaggeration in interpretation is probably earth changes. And I do feel that we're definitely going to get some massive earthquakes and seismic activity in the next 10 years, particularly around the spring of 2000. But I think a lot of those maps, like the Scallion map and others, are actually quite over-exaggerated, and I doubt very much that we will see that kind of a shift of lands. I'll give you an example. One prediction showed England sinking, southwestern England sinking into the Atlantic 7 years before the end of the world. Now, if one loosely attributes that to the year 2000, as many people point to, then it should have sank around 1992-93. What did happen at that time, objectively speaking, is that the southwestern England experienced its heaviest rains in history.
I recall that, yes.
Yeah. So Now you have visions of a man like Nostradamus maybe getting it right, that it saw big floods, but getting it over-exaggerated and saying, oh, it's sinking of southwest England. I mean, certainly if you were under the rain in certain areas, it felt like sinking.
Or maybe England avoided one possible future.
Yes, and on top of that, maybe one of history's greatest prophets over-exaggerated in what must be very difficult for people who have these visions to deal with. You know, you're just minding your own business, and suddenly you see this stunning experience beyond what you understand. And then when you come out of it, you try to share it in what you understand from your own conditionings, mindsets, hopes, and fears.
It's a good question, John. What do the prophets go through? You can only imagine having some kind of vision like that involuntarily would scare the hell out of you. You'd question your own sanity.
Yes.
I would imagine you'd go through all kinds of changes. How have most prophets through history handled it?
Again, it depends on the culture and how the culture accepts its soothsayers. In the case of someone like Nostradamus, he had to be very secretive about it, because he might be burned as a witch. Whereas if, again, a Hopi shaman had such visions, his culture would, or an Aboriginal shaman had such a vision, his culture would support and nurture his ability to communicate it. So a lot of one common thread in a lot of prophetic experiences is some kind of shock that, yes, is either subtle or quite objective, like a blow to the head or something, like Peter Hurkos.
Yes.
That takes you out of your normal way of looking at things. Another way is through mystical practices like meditation or the practice of magic or deep devotional prayer, or the way a Sufi can whirl and whirl on a dime for hours, as the founder of the whirling dervishes, Rumi, did for something like 36 hours, and then when he fell down, it is said he became enlightened. He discovered his what would be in Christian terms is Christ consciousness.
I wonder how many prophets through history, John, who have had these visions involuntarily, instead of being accepted by society, have ended up in loony bins.
Oh, many, many, many. It's a funny similarity. I once had a mystic in India tell me that the difference on the surface between a madman and an enlightened master is, on the surface, doesn't look very different, because they both look like they're out of their mind.
Mm-hmm.
One he described as falling below the mind. And what he said, the enlightened person transcends the mind.
I got an interesting message on internet yesterday that I was going to hold for later in the program, but it's appropriate to read it now. I had a lady yesterday who called me and said she was hearing voices. Hearing voices. She thought people were electronically putting them in her head. Somebody sent me a message on internet and said, if you talk to God, it's praying. If God talks back, it's schizophrenia. And I suppose these prophets are sort of hearing from God, or a God power, or a power, and are diagnosed as schizophrenic many times.
Well, I mean, that same person on internet who said that, I would not want them to say that in the middle of Cairo about Muhammad going up on the mountain.
Indeed.
However, it is it's a fine line. It's a very fine line between madness and messianism. That's what makes it so dangerous, and at the same time a great risk for the seeker of truth, because
yes,
you do go on the fringes of your own mind and see what's there.
Yes, and so if you began to have terrifying visions, John, uncontrollable, terrifying visions that came to you as dreams or even in waking hours.
I had them?
Yeah, if you had them, would you go to the world and offer them up, or would you keep your mouth shut?
Well, it is from my own personal experience, because it has happened sometimes, that I think in the, to adequately study this rather fringy subjective subject as prophecy, you have to have one foot firmly grounded in scholarship, and you have the other one extended out into the mm-hmm, more subjective sides of one's consciousness, and experiment with these things. I can say for myself that it is definitely, it takes a grounding in a certain discipline of self-awareness to not get identified with what is seen to the extent that one takes it so seriously that one becomes almost pathologically responding to what one sees. Given it must have taken a tremendous centeredness of a man like Nostradamus to foresee his own death, to foresee the death of loved ones and the passage of time.
While we're at it, can you give us a sort of a brief primer on Nostradamus in general? A lot of people are not familiar with him, know the name, but don't know much about him, really.
His name became a world-known name during World War II because of both sides, the Nazis and the Allies, used his prophecies and propaganda to prove that their side would win. The man was born in 1503 and died in 1566, and if he hadn't predicted a single prophecy, would, and still often does go down in history books as one of the great healers of the 16th century, a man who's almost single-handedly cured three cities of plague and whooping cough. Of course, what most short histories will say of Nostradamus is that he also wrote this series of 10 volumes of four-line poems called quatrains in a book called The Centuries, which was a history of the future till the end of time. And they will say many people have attributed different interpretations to the centuries, the last four and a half centuries, to this obscure work. And of course, in the new book, I expand on just looking at interpreting the prophecies and take a step back. And actually, my study of Nostradamus is a 15-year study in three steps. The first book that was in 1987 was beginning from the usual homily point of view of narrative.
Mm-hmm.
The second book, this one that's released now, is a little more critical and a little more stepping back from mere interpreting and saying, well, what really is this phenomenon called Nostradamus? How many people have triggered a controversy that remains quite hot 4.5 centuries later? As many greater men have come and gone whose controversies have died.
Does this reflect a more objective a point of view from you? In other words, did you go through some changes personally as you looked at this, continued to look at it over the years?
Oh, yes. I really feel that one must, if only a corpse remains the same, and if one is open to growing one and learning. I mean, I always hope that each book is a quantum leap from the last. When I write another work on collective prophecies, which I intend to do towards the end of this decade, I hope it'll be a whole quantum leap from Millennium Book of Prophecy and what it has to say. I hope that I'll always keep growing and learning. And the book, certainly after 7 to 8 years, has more angles, more facets to the diamond, so to speak. And eventually what will happen is, at the end of the century, I will have a complete Prophecies of Nostradamus, which hasn't been done in completeness since 1962 by Edgar Leone.
Gee, maybe that's ominous by itself.
Well, I would like to release it on July of 1999, the famous doomsday prediction of Nostradamus, and kind of as a pull the tail of the interpretive devil, if you will. If I'm going to do all this work in the next 5 years.
Well, I hope we're about to read it.
This book that's coming out, Nostradamus and New Revelations, is out, and I'm very happy with it. It's really the book I wanted to do in 1987, and it's fully new illustrations. Oh, all my books are coffee table books with pictures and illustrations, having an interplay and text and image on each page.
When you get right down to the nitty-gritty, you talked about the prediction of the plagues, even the curing, I guess, of some of the plagues. What would you consider his most significant predictions to have been?
Well, from the past, certainly the ones made on the French Revolution are quite chilling in their accuracy. His accurate description of Napoleon and his the time that he would rule, 14 years as emperor. The rise and fall of Adolf Hitler, we called Hister.
Yes.
And Napoleon, he called Napoleon Roi, Napoleon the King. It is a anagram from Napoleon. It was a classic anagram for that. A man that would hold, never would be seen a man holding such a ferocious name as a French king. And the, in the case of Hitler, he called him the captain of Greater Germany. Hitler called his empire Gross Deutschland, Greater Germany.
Yes, indeed.
And that he would break unions in 37, 41, 42, and 45. He talks about a great empire falling through an invasion through the Ardennes forest, and it's not in code. He says the Ardennes, and the quatrain is numbered quatrain 45 of that particular volume. In fact, it's century 545. Now, the only major invasions that have happened through the Ardennes of where a whole empire has fallen was in 1940 when Hitler went through the Ardennes to defeat France and thereby, of course, defeat its empire, its holdings around the world. That's one interpretation. Of course, he did it again a few years later where he tried the same trick for the Battle of the Bulge, which is going to be celebrating its 50th anniversary very soon. In this case, his Nazi empire fell. That was his last chance, last gamble. And May, that is 5, of 1945, is the... could be the prediction of the ending date of World War II.
Boy, that's an awful lot of accuracy.
Yeah, that's, just to give another example, you have...
let me correct, that's an awful lot of specific accuracy.
Right, I mean, when you look at the famous prophecy of the flight of the king, Louis the 16th, and his family... they tried to escape the Republican France, and in it he describes the night he will come by the forest of Rien, a married couple, devious root, queen white stone, a monk king in gray in Varennes. Now, first off, on this quatrain is numbered 20.
John, we've got to pause right there.
Okay.
Hold on, quatrain 20. We'll be right back. John Hogue, the world's leading expert on Nostradamus, will be back with us in a moment.
The trip back in time continues with Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM. More Somewhere in Time coming up. Networks presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from the 15th of November, 1994.
Welcome back or into the program. If you are one of those just joining us at this hour, we are honored to have with us, surprise, surprise, everybody, John Hogue, who is none other than the world's leading authority on Nostradamus. He is also the man who will... be the anchor for, certainly the main authority for, the Ancient Prophecies television show coming up at, we believe, 8 o'clock in all time zones this Friday evening. John Hogan, we're talking about, no surprise there, prophecy, predictions, soothsayers, our past and our future. And we'll get back to him in just a moment.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
For many, many years now, John Hogue has been studying prophets and prophecy and soothsayers, and here he is back once again, and we were discussing Quatrain 20, I believe.
This is Quatrain 20 of Century 9, and I will read it again quickly and take it line by line. It's basically about the flight of King Louis XVI and his family and Queen Marie Antoinette from Paris in an attempt to escape revolutionary France in 1791. And it took place on the night of June 20th, 1791. The quatrain is number 20. And it says, by night he will come by the forest of Rennes. Rennes is, they posed as a married couple and not as royalty. They took a large coach and they did pass that forest on their way on a northern route out of Paris. They disguised themselves as a married couple, and they took a lot of changes in their route because they couldn't find enough horses, the right horses, so they had to change for fresh horses. So the next line says, a married couple, devious route. They changed their route from the original plan. And then he says in the next line, Queen White Stone. Now, that is an apt description in three words for Marie Antoinette. Her hair had turned white from the stresses of the revolution. She, the diamond necklace scandal attributed to her was one of the major steps towards a revolution, the White Stone. Mm-hmm. And she was dressed in white, witnesses say, as this wife disguise. The other description was given to the king as looking like a Carmelite monk in gray. They wear a gray smock and a gray hat. And in the next line, he says, a monk king in gray in Varennes. This was reported by witnesses in the town of Varennes, the town where the coach was stopped by the mayor, who was a revolutionary, and the guards then drove the coach back to Paris. The final line talks about the result of this. Elected cap causes tempest, fire, and bloody slicing. Mm-hmm. Now, when you read that just offhand, it looks like a little gobbledygook. And that's why it's important in the study of Nostradamus to really know your history and know it intimately, all the little details.
Oh, yes.
For instance, it is known that when Louis XVI of the House of Bourbon became a constitutional monarch in the beginning of the Revolution, they had him drop his royal name and take the oldest name of his family, which was Capet. He was called Citizen Capet, not King Louis. So elected cap, he was an elected king. The first time France ever had that, elected by the masses.
Hmm.
And the causes tempest, the next two words, is a metaphor often used for the French Revolution as the whirlwind or the tempest in Old French. And certainly it was, poetically speaking, because Nostradamus was a poet as well. And also, the whirlwind is a dating that comes up in a lot of these revolutionary French prophecies because of exactly a year to the day before the storming of the Bastille, there was a huge cyclonic storm that hit northwest France, and there were a lot of cyclones and tornadoes that actually went past Paris and up all the way to Tours, and it was called the Whirlwind. You can see it in old French newspapers, which I have of the time.
Huh.
So anyway, the elected cap causes tempest, fire, and bloody slicing. Of course, fire is a description of the wars and the revolution, and the bloody slicing, of course, is the guillotine, if we are to attribute this slant of interpretation.
Yes.
I think it's pretty hard not to, after looking at all the other bits of evidence. Now, I mean, this is quite condensed in a prophecy that is over 300 years old.
I had no idea that so much of it was so specific, John. I thought it was more open to interpretation, but as you apply the history that you so carefully checked on, it seems very specific.
Well, it is true for a lot of the prophecies that they're quite obscure. And I have a few theories I'm proposing in the new book on Nostradamus about that. To give you an example, one of the most famous prophecies of Nostradamus, which made him famous in his own time, was Century 1, Quatrain 35, concerning the king of his own king, King Henry II, dying in a jousting tournament, being blinded in the eye through a gilded cage. His helmet visor was made of gold, and a piece of a javelin, well, not javelin, a piece of a jousting stick penetrated the cage right behind his eye, blinded him, and basically gave him a mortal wound. And this is one prophecy, one quantum future, if you will. Now there are about a dozen other prophecies clearly using anagrams for Henry II that describe in detail the man conquering northern Italy, keeping the peace between the Protestants and Catholics and citizens of France, and basically becoming someone equal to, if not transcending, the power of Charles V of the Holy Roman Empire, is near contemporary, well, his contemporary. And now none of that happened. Now, and most scholars go, well, Nostradamus got that one wrong, didn't he? And maybe he did. However, another possibility, and perhaps one of the reasons why so many of the quatrains are obscure, is that maybe that was a quantum future that could have been accessed if he'd heeded the warning not to joust. So what we may be doing now, and I pose in this essay in the book, that many of the famous 200 or so quatrains that most scholars like myself like to cite about the accuracy of Nostradamus may, if the king had not followed that quantum future and followed the other one.
John, must have forced you to do a lot of thinking about the nature of time.
Absolutely. I mean, that's one of my core passions about all of this. I always love a good time travel story. I mean, when I was a little kid, I saw, the Time Machine, and I ran off and read the book by H.G. Wells, and I have a passion for that. A
couple of questions for you. Faxed in. Dear Art, will you please ask John who he was referring to regarding recent prophets, which he described as startlingly accurate?
You mean as mystics?
Modern-day mystics, prophets that you did describe as very accurate.
Well, Edgar Cayce was one. Count Louis Hamon, who died in 1935, was better known as for his pseudonym Quiro, the palmist book writer about palmistry. Mm-hmm. His books are considered like the Bible of palmistry readers. He was quite a good prophet in the hardest disciplines of dating times and for events and naming outright things. Edgar Cayce, who died in 1945, certainly is one of the greats. Humble.
How about real modern day? Anybody out there right now?
Well, yeah, surprisingly, someone who died just recently, who was quite controversial in Oregon as a mystic, that was, is people call him Osho now, but his name at that time was Bhagwan. Bhagwan.
Rajneesh, yes. Oh, Bhagwan, yes.
Very accurate. That was quite surprising to me, because as far as I understand from examining his, I mean, one of the other major pursuits I have, other than prophecy, and probably will write a lot of books about it in the following decade, is a close examination, intimate examination of new religious movements, because they may end up being the great religions of the next millennia. And so that's what I pose. So I study them and keep in touch with them. In the case of this man, he was very anti-future in most of his visions of how he saw things.
Anti-future?
Well, he basically felt that tomorrow never comes and the past is dead and you only live now. And I found that rather intriguing, that a man who has such strong views about living in the now should be so accurate about predicting the future. I mean, he has had his daily discourses throughout his life transcribed into over 700 books.
Wow.
350 of which are in English. And I have perused through all of them and gathered. What I usually do in my work is I I gather anything that's prescient or prophetic, and I put it on a little card. I have this big wall in my flat where, where I have, it's all cork, and I just pin them all up on the wall, and then I use my bit of dyslexia in a way that's very helpful, and that is that you can see things vertically and backwards and forwards a lot easier when you're a bit dyslexic.
So if a large event occurs, you go to the wall.
Yeah, I go to the wall. And what I immediately observed is that the incredible accuracy of past predictions the man made about India, about things that would happen, the fact that he had foreseen the AIDS way ahead of a lot of people and described a lot of things that people just laughed him off the map for, about condoms and gloves and safe sex, and that it would be part of policy soon in many countries.
Are there any contemporary predictions or any at all regarding what would seem to be AIDS and where it's going to go, John?
Unfortunately, many, and to expand the theme, not just AIDS, but in my first book on Nostradamus, I was pretty focused on AIDS, but one of the things to answer further that question, first facts, that it is expanded to include all diseases, if you will, that affect the immune system of not only man, but his animals and his food chains. And there, in the Millennium Book of Prophecy, I look at many prophecies in what I call the chapter of the Lemming Syndrome, looking at plagues. And there are a lot of prophecies about ozone holes.
Are there really?
Yes, and often it comes up as swords cutting the sky. That's the way some Renaissance German prophets talk about it, and let in lethal rays by cutting up the sky. If you were a man from the 17th century or 16th century, you might view a rocket as a sword.
Indeed.
I mean,
indeed, and we just sent up a sword here in the last a few days to take a very good and careful look. I believe they dispatched a little baby sword while they were up there to take a good look at the ozone hole.
Yes.
And that's been retrieved now back on Earth, and I guess we're reviewing the information right now, but the indications are that the ozone hole has expanded.
Well, and then you get Nostradamus talking about a great plague from the skies covering the entire northern hemisphere. And then he dates it beginning around 1993.
Mm.
And you get like the Swiss mystic, the early 20th century, saying, I'm sure she didn't know about Goddard's toy rockets at that time, because she was around making this prediction at that time. She said, in the near future, people will make pencil planes that will punch holes in the atmosphere, let in lethal rays that will kill tens of millions.
Sure sounds like rockets to me.
Yes, and of course, ultimately, what I hope people will do when they read this book and see the correlation of all these different times, people saying the same thing generally, is not to feel chest fall and think, oh, there's nothing we can do, but actually become more activistic, you know, and put more pressure on their governments to be more responsible about CFCs and other things that eat the ozone layer, and maybe encourage more for NASA to look at projects that actually can replenish the ozone. And I saw something recently in Discover magazine.
It could be done.
Oh, certainly. We can fix it. That's the thing. I hope that people will not use these prophecies to just feed their lack of ability to respond, responsibility to the situation.
All right, try this one out for size. Art, could you ask John, please, to comment on the angelic earthquake warnings in Seattle? Are you familiar with them at all, John? There have been many recent angelic warnings.
There was also the same happening for Jupiter on the Santa Monica Freeway about a month before it, the strikes on Jupiter by the comet Shoemaker-Levy.
Yes.
Again, like the Earth changes, one of the other areas where there's a lot of exaggeration is usually the collective visions of armies of angels in the sky, it's happened many times before, or angels coming down to make warnings concerning an event.
We're actually having angel mania across America right now.
It's one of the many symptoms of kind of, somewhat authentic and mostly mass hysterical events that are going to be common in the next 7 or so years concerning millennial feelings.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly in my own studies of the occult and astral projection, I mean, at one time I was even one of the 50,000 or so white mice in the experiment that Robert Monroe was doing with the Gateway program.
Oh, I know all about it. I interviewed Robert.
Yes. Great work what he does. I know that there are definitely a lot more people around than we can see just with the physical eyes. Some of them nice, some of them not so nice, some of them quite evolved, and it could be very easily attributed to angelic projections onto those people.
And you attribute it instead to what Mr. Monroe suggests occurs with the soul?
With the soul?
With the soul. Well, with the soul, in essence.
Well, I remember in his Far Journeys, the book just before Ultimate Journeys, he talked at length about the people, what he called it, as being on the sixth plane.
That's right.
Yes, although they could not really understand those who were in the seventh plane. And I think, I certainly would say there's definitely many mystics, including someone, again, like Osho, said, always open yourself to higher energies. Mm-hmm. You know, and if they, the thing that where I would be more standoffish is to say, or just simply not, less identified with, is to say that sometimes what we personify is not that what we're seeing is in a persona, but it's how we, again, interpret what's happening. We see the persona of an angel, for instance, when people have had near-death experiences. I've also had one.
Oh, you have?
Yes, I was in an auto accident. Actually, it's the start of this new Millennium Book of Prophecy. I describe my own brush with death.
Yes, would you be willing to describe that for us?
Well, basically, I had had a very... It was back in 1981 on Ash Wednesday. In March of 81, I had just come back from India from a meditation retreat, and I had was hovering at the door to. I was going to go visit my girlfriend, Time, who was about a 2-hour drive down from Palos Verdes to Long Beach. She was going to fix me dinner, and I just called her up and said, "I'm coming." And
right.
So that's the preamble. And then I was at the door, and I couldn't go any farther. I had this immense feeling that something, like you were saying before, big was going to happen, something momentous.
Yes.
It felt like a little ant that was going to be crushed by something I couldn't even see. And I said to my mother, I said, why can't I get out of here? What is happening? And then I just hovered and waited there at the door, and then something kind of just pushed me out. Got in the car. 20 minutes later, I was going through an intersection in Long Beach, and someone ran the red light at 55 miles an hour and hit me in the driver's door of my little two-door Maverick. And, it was quite an amazing experience to see the force of that collision. I was wearing my seatbelt, that's why I'm still here. It was almost like steel and metal and plastic started ripping away from me like garments, like sheets being ripped. It was amazing to see the fluidity of things in that one shattering moment. And at that moment, I was propelled into all I can explain is a golden void. It was vast like the sky. It was everything and nothing at the same time. Very paradoxical experience.
I've never had such an accident, so I've got to stop you and ask you. Go back to that moment of metal crushing. Was it fast in time, John, or did it play out slowly? As you think of it now, did it play out as it was occurring slowly to you?
Well, that's the funny thing about these events. Time really gets warped, and it did play slowly. It's almost like it stood still, and yet it was paradoxical too. It's where in not only in the accident, but even in the, that golden space.
Did you
it
have
was
time?
Like I could live a million years.
Right, John, did you have time to think you were going to die?
We can follow that.
We're going to have to follow that. We're going to have to break here. We'll be right back. My guest, the world's expert on Nostradamus, John Hogue.
This is Premier Networks. That was Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM on this Somewhere in Time. Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
My guest is John Hogue. John Hogue can be seen on the Ancient Prophecies television program this coming Friday evening on NBC. I suspect 8 o'clock or so. Check your local listings. But we believe 8 o'clock in most time zones. He is indeed the world's expert on Nostradamus. And I suspect many other prophets, soothsayers, and that's what we're talking about. We'll get back to them in just a moment. You're listening to America's largest, fastest-growing all-night talk show. This is Coast to Coast AM.
Now, we take you back to the past on Art Bell Somewhere in Time.
Once again, John Hogue. John, we were right in the middle of a car crash. And there it was, the metal crunching about you. And I've often wondered, you know, myself, and I think a lot of us have, were we to be involved in something like that, what would that last instant be like?
Well, in my case, I can only speak for that it was, having had a brush with sudden death, I've come out of it with one desire, and that is that it, next time when I actually do die, I'd rather die a much slower way where I can watch it stage by stage and try to retain awareness through the whole process. Many of the mystics of the East say that death is the ultimate orgasmic experience of life, is the culmination of life.
Maybe even take notes that your relatives can publish.
Yes, or all I can say is that having experienced brushes with sudden death, it would be more blessing, even if there's pain in a slower death, to be available to see it as it comes, in my opinion. I'd rather be open to that.
Fascinating. All right, well, I don't want to stop you from your story. Anyway, here the car crashed, and I guess you... What happened to you?
Well, there was no time to think about dying, because I wasn't dead, in a way. I was... thrown into this state of goldenness, and it's very difficult to explain in dialectics of words what this was, except that it was quite paradoxical that I was everywhere and nowhere at the same time, and that I was not thereing, so to speak, as much as I had been thereing in my body just the moment before as a person in a body. And I recall presences there who were very loving and impressing upon me without words, without anything, in fact. It was like pure communication that I didn't have to go back.
Did you, John, sorry, I've got to ask these questions. Did you have a consciousness as you have at this moment as you talk with us? Was there a consciousness, or was it something beyond what we know as consciousness?
Well, I would say it was my first very strong, well, one of my first very strong tastes of a glimpse of what our consciousness can be if we get beyond our identifications with our conditionings, our predictability, our ideas that we just take for granted as truth, when in fact we never, and unfortunately most cultures don't even help us to question everything and to doubt everything that is put in our brains as children.
So it was a raised consciousness.
It was, yes, it was an awakening, and it was a glimpse of what is possible. And in a way, since the experience, it has made it much easier to deal with the trials and tribulations of life, because but the effort is for me to remember that there was this. I only have a taste of it as a memory now in my conscious state. But
what a shame.
But it is, there are times when through meditation, through the practice of the science of self-observation, I can get detached from my emotions and my feelings and be able to watch them. And in that state, there are times, even in my daily meditation, where I feel the gap of that same state is possible, is there. And so, I mean, for 20 years now, I've been a practitioner of meditation techniques. Many of them I describe in the narrative for the new book, because there are many prophecies concerning meditation as the next step after superstitious and orthodox religions.
All right. Well, I still want to get through this.
Yes.
You said
so much to cover.
You said you had a choice.
Well, yes, I had a choice, and I had a glimpse of the potentials of the next years of my life, and in that split second, I saw about the potential that could fill 7 decades worth of living, just in a split second, and
what
realized that once I got back, this is the state not only of myself, but the state of everyone when they're awakened, that glimpse that I had. I thought, well, when I go back to normal Long Beach, California, I'll probably kick myself. but I also know that if I even manage to live those 7 more decades, it'll be all like a snap of a finger compared to what I've just tasted.
Yes.
And so I definitely am one of those people who's come out of a near-death experience. I was gone for 20 minutes. They were down in normal time and space continuum. The paramedics were working on the other man, and they basically couldn't get my door open, and they thought I was dead.
When you say gone?
Well, I mean, they saw me slumped over, ashen-faced. They thought that I had been concussed or dead, and they were working on the other man who had hit me. And I know all this because of witnesses. When I decided to go back, I kind of came back into my body, and the first thing I noticed was that my body wasn't broken. And I looked around, and I saw that the dashboard had been made into an accordion. It took most of the force of the collision. Mm. Another split second, he would have hit me square in the door, and that would have killed me. The foot pedals were tied in a bow tie. I still don't know how that happened, but they were all tied in a bow tie. Drive shaft was bent. Seats were at odd angles.
And you were in one piece.
Yeah, I was. I looked and I kept saying, well, there's no cuts, no bruises, no broken bones. I was very calm and cool when I came back. I felt like I was a time traveler coming back from a million light year journey or something. I was so deeply refreshed and calm, and yet surrounded by chaos and destruction, you know. And I hear this tap, 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 and I look and see this ashen-faced paramedic saying, screaming through the window, "Can you get out?" And I went, yeah, about like that, you know. I think he was asking me for the time.
Did you tell them about it?
No, I didn't tell anyone about it for about a week. But I've never felt the same after the experience.
Everybody who's been in that says that.
It's almost like you get such a strong shock to your attachments to what you think is life and what you think is your fear of death, that when you're so deeply shocked on that level, you come out of it you never can get the connection to your attachments, to your points of view about life and death in the same way. I've heard many people having the same experience having said that, even if they experienced different things. I mean, one thing I experienced when I was out of my body in that state was that I tried, parts of me somehow were trying to reach the people I was attached to and loved. Like, I remember hovering over my mother, trying to tell her that something happened, and instant same time I kind of felt I was going into my girlfriend's body and watching her cutting carrots in the kitchen.
Wow.
And then she stopped and folded her hands thoughtfully. And later, a few weeks afterwards, I asked her what she was feeling at the time, and what she told me, what I recall her saying is, after you called, I went into the kitchen, started cutting vegetables and cutting carrots, and about 20 minutes into it, I realized you were not coming and something terrible had happened to you. I just had this feeling that something very bad had happened, and I got the phone call and from the hospital. So that was some objective verification of what I was experiencing outside of my normal conscious state.
Well, if something like that wouldn't change your life forevermore, I cannot think of anything that would.
Well, and what I try to do in applying it to this book is that taking the personal experience to the impersonal, to the collective, if the prophets are indicating that all of humanity is going to have a brush with sudden death in the coming decades, on a collective level, global level, hopefully we can use that as the same shock to change the way we live.
Maybe it will take that, and one can only wonder about the form it will take. Look, I've got several questions, so we've got to try to run through them quickly and then get the lines open at the top of the hour.
Right.
All right. Could you have John address Nostradamus' prophecy on the description of the Antichrist? I've heard that the Antichrist was born February 2nd, 1965. I believe there is mention of a man in dark blue or a dark blue turban. Thanks, Adolf, in Wichita, Kansas.
Okay, the blue turban interpretation comes from one of the finer scholars of the last generation of Nostradamians, that was Erica Cheatham. And that was in lieu of her interpretation that it was blue or black turbans of the Ayatollahs of Iran. Definitely a potential candidate, but just quickly before I get into that, Nostradamus predicted three antichrists that would take us three steps towards Armageddon. The first was Napoleon, second was Hister, or Hitler. The third is a contemporary who will make his moves shortly after, a few years after, a celestial event with a comet. That's either dating 1986 or 1994 with Comet Shoemaker-Levy hitting Jupiter and the previous one being Halley's Comet. So we're definitely in the time to see who that is. Now, my interpretation on this is similar to many others, that it is someone from the Middle East or North Africa. But where I vary from other scholars is that I think that the person who Nostradamus calls Mabus, M-A-B-U-S, is not a major figure like the first two antichrists, but someone more like an Oswald or a Gavrilo Princip who assassinates Franz Ferdinand and triggers World War I. Someone who could be as minor as one of the 200 members of Abu Nidal, terrorist group, who has a suitcase full of plutonium or something like that. And
what about the blue helmets of the UN, John?
Well, blue, I'm actually re-examining all applications of the word blue in old French. Right now I'm going through a process where I'm looking at every 34,000 plus words of Nostradamus and taking an exhaustive study of their etymology through the centuries. I'm re-examining all that about the blue helmets.
All right. All right.
That'll come out in the next book.
All right. I am an officer in a civil defense organization in the Kansas City area listening to you on KCMO 810. Ask your guest what we here in the Midwest need to know about the next few years. What do we need to prepare for? What does he think is headed our way? How does he think we ought to prepare? That's from Independence, Missouri.
Well, I think that the people in Missouri should continue to work hard to prepare for earthquakes and be more earthquake conscious and try to make their towns safer. And it would be good for people to learn earthquake drills and do some of the things that people in California and the West Coast do, because there's a good chance of some earthquake activity taking place in the next 10 years in that region. Certainly, the gosh, it's such a loaded question, so many angles to it. Essentially, everybody has to do.
They can take it, John.
Yeah, is be open to the unknown. And this is true of the Midwest. It's true of all peoples of the world. Be ready. You know, the thing is that we always think we're afraid of the unknown. But in fact, we're afraid of what we know, because we keep thinking what traumas that have happened in our knowledge of the past is going to be repeated in the future. And then we somehow are conditioned to think that the unknown is something terrifying.
Are you prepared to argue history does not repeat itself?
Well, I think we've reached a point in our evolution where, for the first time, the human race has to grow up. That means one of the things that we have to stop doing is repeating history and being so predictable. I'm anti-prophetic, and I have a rather strange, eccentric angle of dealing with that. I learn every nook and cranny about the subject. In a way, my discipline is more of an Eastern form of Tantra, where you know a thing and transcend it rather than repress it. And I think essentially what everybody needs to see is how we keep repeating the mistakes of the past and we call it the future.
Have you checked your own attitude for denial?
Oh, absolutely. This is the key in my work, is in the narrative. I try not to talk down to people as if I know anything. In fact, I have a note at the beginning of the book saying, look, you know, I'm just another person. Mm-hmm. What I'm sharing with you is that my study is exhaustive and my practice of meditation has been 2 decades now, and I claim that that helps me to kind of step back and not only view my own biases and prophetic hopes and fears, but also, you know, on a collective level, see that reflected in the rest of the world. And that, at least, is what I'm posing in my work. It's very important to know your own prophetic biases.
Yes. Greetings, John and Art. A question: are there any prophecies concerning people being attracted to people they have known in past lifetimes? This would be a gathering of old souls whose paths have crossed in one or more previous lives. I have had some startling indications that this gathering is actually occurring. Are there prophecies about this?
Well, one concerning Osho again, actually just recently before he died, said that many of the great masters and adepts and bodhisattvas, that's people, devotees that are dedicated their many lives to helping humanity grow and kind of hurdle over this most difficult passage that we'll probably ever see, are among us today. Perhaps that, again, is another reason why some people authentically are experiencing something angelic, and I'm attributing that label to it. But there's a lot of energy, a lot of forces, and a lot of souls in the world right now trying to help this world move through this. And I would add that we have, 5.5 billion souls actually in Earth bodies right now.
Yes.
That's probably the most significant number of people in the world in one time. And one would think that the coming ages may see a dramatic decrease in population, so it's almost like a last chance for a lot of people for a very long time to incarnate on this planet.
Yeah, is there really any way, as I look ahead, if I were to try my hand at prophecy, I would say that the continuing population build will not continue.
It cannot.
It cannot, right.
Unless we have a quantum change leap in our technologies. I mean, we could sustain 50 billion people on this planet and spaciously. But to do that, we would have to change 180 degrees. A lot of what we hold as hallowed icons of truth and justice and morality. I mean, it would be a very different world. I mean, that is possible. However, the way the trend is going, we are too divisive right now, too split, too schizophrenic in our dividing the world into 300 nations, 300 mindsets on God, it goes on and on. This is one of the things that will not survive well in the coming century, simply because of the necessity of human survival to drop anything that does not help planned parenting, does not help population control.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's going to be a tough time for people in Orthodox religions, like leaders of Orthodox religions like the Pope, to hold on to ideas like contraception as being a sin. What is screaming all over the world is that too many people blindly being birthed into this world without enough resources is a greater sin.
Well, I could not agree more, and I'm afraid that if we're waiting Rome's change of heart and mind on this issue, the world is doomed. John, here's another one. Iran's recent agreement with Russia will be the hook predicted in Ezekiel 37 and 38, which will bring Gog down into Israel and start the beginning of the last days. That's from Dennis in Missoula, Montana.
The indications for Armageddon are that many of the final steps towards that are there, including the fact that peace will be at hand in the Middle East, that it will appear that the Arab and the Jew have found a way to live in harmony in the Middle East. Other indications are this will happen around the time when the Euphrates dries up. There are times in the last few years when the Ataturk Dam project, a big, huge water hydraulic project in Turkey, which is the headwaters to the Euphrates, has cut off the flow of the Euphrates by 75% at times. The Middle East has a very serious problem with water shortage.
Yes.
Certainly, if the Euphrates dries up, or they estimate that if things go the way they are going, in 10 years it will be dried up. There could very easily be a war in that area.
All right, John, let's hold it right there. I need to get to the top of the hour and do something here very quickly, and then we will open the telephone lines.
The trip back in time continues with Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM. More Somewhere in Time coming up. Take you back to the past on Art Bell Somewhere in Time.
This is kind of the final wave of the stations joining us at this hour. If you are joining us at this hour, I'm sorry for you. You have missed 2 hours, two incredible hours with John Hoag. But you haven't missed it all because he's still here. Who's John Hoag? John Hoag is none other than the world's leading authority on Nostradamus. He's got several books published. We'll tell you all about them shortly. We've been talking about the nature of, well, I guess a lot, Nostradamus, soothsayers, prediction, the nature of time, near-death experiences, and you'll get the taste of it in just a moment. We're about to open up the telephone lines. I do want to once again promo the fact that you will see John Hoag this Friday on Ancient Prophecies on the NBC television network, 8 o'clock p.m., most time zones, if not all. Check your local television guide. John is the technical expert and will be seen frequently on, as a matter of fact, a lot of his books are the basis for that television program. We'll get back to John Hoag in just a moment.
You're You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
If you all are ready, let us bring back once again John Hogue. John?
Yes.
All right, good. If you wouldn't mind, let's travel to the world of who knows where and see what's out there. We don't screen calls, John, so anything can happen.
I'm ready.
here we go. On the wild card line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hello. Well, see, anything can happen, as in nobody being there, or how about this one? On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue.
Yes, John. This is Brian from Austin, Texas.
Hi, Brian.
Hi. I was wondering, what did you, what was your conjecture about how Nostradamus came by his prognostications?
Well, he claims that it was a gift of his progenitors, his genetic, hereditary. He also said that his son wouldn't have the gift, that it would die with him. So, essentially, that's his claim.
Mm. All right.
All right, thank you.
Thank you very much for the call. On the wild card line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning.
Morning, Mr. Bell.
Hi.
I'd like to ask your guest, what does the Nostradamus prediction say will be the condition of Israel at the end of time? And this is Sam, by the way, from Chico.
Chico, all right.
And if he's ever read the book I mentioned to you last week called The Protocols of the Elders of Zion, in which the Zionist group that wrote the book say that a descendant of the of King David will rule the world.
Well, there is a common hope of many prophetic traditions, Judeo-Christian, Judaic, the Hindu, the Muslim, all are waiting for a certain messianic figure that is going to rule the world, basically. The Christians think the second coming of Christ, the Muslims think about the 12th Imam, the Buddhists are waiting for Maitreya, the friend. And in the end of Millennium Book of Prophecy, I have a page full of lists that even cites Eskimo prophets, Eskimo messiahs, as well as the mainstream messiahs. And it's basically called Name That Messiah. And essentially what I'm getting at is that almost every religion, every prophetic tradition has their man as the man coming back, and all the others as false prophets.
There is, nevertheless, a great commonality there.
Yes, and that's certainly they're all seeing something. They're all seeing something happening around now. So that is very significant. What we need to do is perhaps be a little less identified with the personifications and the particular politically correct slant of each religion so that we can step back a bit and just look at the phenomenon. Something amazing is coming. Something messianic is coming. But whether it's a person or whether it's an impersonal experience of a collective lift in consciousness, an impersonal messiah, if you will, that is, rather than looking for someone to take on your sins and your burdens and your responsibilities, you as an individual suddenly awaken to your own Buddha consciousness or Christ consciousness within. On a collective scale, that may be what the Aquarian Age is about, rather than a return of the Piscean Age messiahs.
Makes me feel as though I had a brace against my desk. All right, on the wild card line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning.
All right, how you doing?
Just fine. Where are you, sir?
Simi Valley, California.
Okay.
I've got a problem with Nostradamus' claim of the Antichrist and Armageddon. I'd like to comment on.
Go ahead.
The Bible says, I've studied biblical prophecy for 15 years. I'm not a Bible thumper, and I don't go to church. But I try to be a Christian and everything. But the Bible says that the Antichrist will be a European and will take over the second symbolic rising of the Roman Empire, which today, as we know, is the European Union. And I think by the late 90s, we'll see Europe rise up like a United States of Europe type of deal, which will become global. And the Antichrist will take that over. and then signed a treaty with Israel, a global type treaty, like a New World Order type of deal. And 7 years after that, it's called the 7-year tribulation, and that's when the Lord's going to return. And in between that time is when World War III will happen, Armageddon, and all the other fun things, the earth changes and everything we've been talking about. And I'd like to know your guest comment on this. Oh, yeah, Armageddon. I think that's when the Western nations and the Asian army, the 200 million man army, will come marching across the Middle East and across the Euphrates River. And they'll try to prevent the Lord from returning, and he'll wipe them out and set up the Millennium Kingdom.
All right, John, that's a lot to comment on.
Yes, I'll essentially, for a long, something very significant happening in our time. I'm going to dedicate almost a whole book to it in a few years. You have one of the most influential religions in the world is Christianity right now. And, you know, it has the Judeo-Christian ethic is basically our, whether a person is actually a Christian or not, is quite dominant in the world of our modern-day civilization. Also, what is quite dominant is a mass idea of interpreting the Bible a certain way. And one of the dangers in collective interpretation is that you, if you can convince enough people that a certain set of things have to happen before your man, your Messiah comes, then you're almost trying to self-fulfill the destruction of half the world. And that is, and the question that we must all be alert to and be more observant of is that, am I creating doomsday, self-fulfilling it, or am I being warned not to
create? I suppose doomsday. We're quite capable of bringing it on, aren't we?
Well, consider this. A man like Pat Robertson was trying to become president of the United States.
Yes.
Now, the man is a sincere man. If he had become president of the United States, and with his deep convictions in that particular doomsday scenario, which is pretty much the man from Simi Valley pretty much expressed the basic idea of this that you get on most evangelical shows, which I do watch in my study. And now, if that man becomes president of the United States, can he be completely sure that on an unconscious level, there isn't a part of him that might want to fall into fulfilling that as the most powerful man in the world and do things in his policy that kind of backwards into those self-fulfilling prophecies?
As, David Koresh fulfilled his own...
Well, the thing, another kind of danger point in the messianic ideas of the Judeo-Christian world is that this has not been the first time, perhaps the last time, that certain sects of Christianity has put their spin on the revelation prophecies. And, I mean, Jim Jones did it, Koresh did it. And all I'm saying is for us to be aware that even the mainstream Christian church has a certain collective interpretation these days that a lot of destruction of the earth and of people has to happen before the second coming of Christ. Whether that's prophecy or projection is something we all have to ask ourselves when we look at prophecy.
So then you would not be all that comfortable with the election to that office of somebody of that sort?
Well, no. I would be more comfortable with someone who is a little more disassociated with his wish-fulfilling desires on a religious level. I think it would... Yes, basically, that's what I would say. Zealots are dangerous, you know, even well-meaning zealots and not so well-meaning zealots. I mean, zeal has a certain way of getting one rather narrow and single-pointed, you know.
So extremism, even perhaps in the stated cause of liberty, could be damn dangerous.
Well, yes. I mean, I'll never forget the day that someone read me a speech. It was in the 60s, and I was really feeling frustrated about the lack of law and order, and somebody read me this speech. And it was a really beautiful speech about what we must do for law and order and to protect our homes and families. And I listened to it and went, wow, that's really great. Who wrote that? And the man said, Adolf Hitler, 1927. And
yes.
I was like shocked, you know, and I realized that, you see, consciousness, self-awareness, is, as far as I'm concerned, is the only virtue, and unconsciousness is the only sin. If you're from, and I speak, of course, it's just one man, my experience.
Collectively, yes.
Yeah, that a lot of, I mean, you could call it a good thing that we healed a lot of the childhood diseases that allows most children who would have died before the 1920s, would have died before they're 5 years old, now got to live and have full lives. But is it a completely a good thing, or is there an unconsciousness in it? Because certainly by creating a longer lasting life, we have had this population explosion, which is now threatening the life of the planet.
All right, or perhaps even a better example would be Bangladesh or one of those countries where people are, as a natural course, starving to death. Literally dropping in the streets. We've had lots of recent examples of it, seen all the pictures. And we go running over there and feed them. And we feed them to the point that they're ready to multiply. They have very little else to do other than sex. It's a great enjoyment. They do lots of that. And so in the end, our action really, if you get down and dirty about it, causes the extended suffering of many more.
Yes, you see, it's like we do things halfway. And it's very much a symptom of unconscious reactions to things. Even when people in their hearts and in their sincerity reach out to help, it's like because we are not fully conscious of the consequences of our responsibilities, it seems that we, in our good, there's a hidden curse, and sometimes in our evil actions, there may be a hidden virtue. I guess I've lived too long in the East, and basically have lived quite a lot of my time in India in the last decade, and Thailand and other places in the East, and I feel that living with the people in the East, that they have a very different way of looking at things, more, I wouldn't say amoral, because we've attributed that word to be negative. I would say more transmoral. There are certain where you kind of the watcher of good and evil, but not the good and evil.
You mentioned Thailand. Bangkok, John, is in the process, according to a lot of people that I've talked to, of self-destruction.
Yes.
With regard to AIDS.
Yes, and Bombay is even worse right now.
Even worse.
Yes.
We've got to get to these phone lines, so talk around them here. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hoag. Good morning.
Good morning. I was wondering, you touched on things like Armageddon and the Antichrist, but I never hear you talk about the prophecy that's probably one-third of the Bible. And why don't you give credence to Jesus Christ?
All right, well, that's fair enough.
Prophet.
Where are you calling from, sir?
I'm calling from Clearwater, Florida.
Clearwater, Florida. All right, John, what about that? There is a very great deal of prophecy in the Bible. Very clear, very even itself very specific.
I think I have about 200 of my 777 prophecies in Millennium Book of Prophecy are from the Bible, from the Old and New Testaments. From the three Isaiahs and the 23 Daniels, and that's one thing I want to say is that there's actually many people writing under the name Isaiah and Daniel and other prophets, and that I include in this work. I also talk about, I never mention when there's a prophecy by Jesus, I have dozens of them in the book. They're fantastic prophecies. But I don't call him Jesus. I call him by the name he really had, Yeshua.
Mm-hmm.
And I do that as a statement, editorial statement, to show how things can be changed with time. All the religions seem to suffer from revision as the millennia pass by. And, you know, it's difficult to separate the orthodoxy and the dogma from the actual living teaching of any catalyst for a new religion, be he Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, and what have you. And
So the answer is he needs to read your book.
Well, the answer I would also say is that often people say, well, it says in Scripture this and that, and I often interrupt and say, oh, you mean Buddhist Scripture? And they go, no, I mean in Scripture. And I go, oh, you mean the Quran?
Yeah.
No. And it's just like, what I try to expose in my work is the kind of the blinders that every group has. I mean, I've talked to the Hal Lindseys of nearly every mainstream religion, and they have, with as much conviction and sincerity, showed me how their prophecies are right and the Christian prophecies are wrong, and vice versa. And so this kind of single-pointed fixation of each dogmatic point of view of each religion is something that really has to be examined in the coming years.
You could hear the edge of almost anger in his voice.
I'm sure what I was saying has hurt him and maybe thousands of others in the last 5 minutes of things I've been saying. It's, rather than be hurt, just observe it. See if it's true for you. If it's not, it's not. I'm no threat to Jesus Christ or Muhammad or anybody else. I'm just a man. I'm just
Well, but you're John Hogue. You do major network television shows. You're here on a national radio show. To many, you are bigger than life, and they hang upon every word.
Well, that I'm glad you put that out, because the responsibility of each person is to, you know, look at it, and I would hope they will doubt what I'm saying in the way the word originally was intended in its Indo-European roots, to hover between yes and no. Not to be skeptic in that I walk in already saying no, or doubting as being something negative. Doubting is neutral.
All right, that's a good point to break. And that's what we're going to do, break here at the bottom of the hour. My guest is John Hogue. He is the world's expert right now on Nostradamus and his predictions.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994. Presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from the 15th of November, 1994.
Welcome back to the best, the largest live overnight talk radio program in America, because this radio station, the one you're listening to, cares enough to have live talk radio on at this hour. Our guest is John Hogue. He is the world's expert on Nostradamus, predictions, prophecy. He can be seen this coming Friday night on Ancient Prophecies, the television show on NBC. If you have questions, we'll get back to him in just a moment.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
Back now to John Hogue from Denver, Colorado. Could you please ask Mr. Hogue the following? In your opinion, you stated that there are a quantum of possible futures. Could you elaborate? And then also, would you comment on the statement, a future already known is past? That's from Denver. John?
Yes, well, that, there is, I love that quote, actually, because there is some truth to that. We are, I would say, you know, you always hear about Generation X, the youngest generation, coming
yes.
up, the baby busters,
yes.
right, boomers, as having no future. Well, frankly, I've not yet found anybody to support that any generation has had a future. I don't think we've had a future. We've been always repeating the past and calling it the future because I feel we program our generations to follow the same mindsets that we followed into wars and waves of extreme left or right leaning and what have you. I mean, it's the pattern that is almost all too predictable without any sense of clairvoyance.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the first half, that yeah, it isn't the future. I agree. We're repeating the past.
And let's see, what was the other part? Quantum of futures.
Well, the quantum future is, in the case of Nostradamus, most 800 or 900 of his prophecies are very obscure and open to all kinds of interpretation. There's some reasons for that. One is that they're wrong. Second, there's an estimation that his history of the future goes into the 9th millennium after Christ. So they might be about events way beyond even our existence on this planet, which is also inferred in his prophecies. The one that I think is most likely is that they are these quantum futures, these roads of collective potentials that, because a major figure like the King of France didn't survive a jousting accident, didn't avoid it, did not trigger a whole set of French history, which, since French history was dominating the continental European history for so many centuries, would have taken us perhaps a completely different angle, which would have made Hitler and World War II and Napoleon and all of that just a lot of obscurity in the quatrain.
Or if Kennedy hadn't been shot.
Right. Yeah. There's an indication implied in the prophecies that if this is attributed to Kennedy, then he would have been a great king. It's the same with the abdication of Edward VIII to Mary Wallace Simpson. The indication is very clear there that Nostradamus didn't have a lot of high words to say of George. King George came after him, said he wasn't a man ready for kingship, and that the real great king was the one they forced out and became Duke of Windsor. In my final book on Nostradamus, I'm going to look at those quantum futures and actually try to translate them or interpret what I think are, rather than obscure prophecies, but actually quantum futures that we didn't follow.
I would imagine, with the many, many years of research you've done, both into real history and his predictions, you probably are just about to the point where you may be one of the world's best people to actually interpret.
Well, I guess the ultimate judge on that will be time, and the people of the future will have to examine my works. I mean, what I try to do in all radio and TV shows is I try to get tapes and transcribe everything, and actually what I did in Nostradamus' New Revelations is be a little critical of some of my prophetic interpretations from the first Nostradamus book, as using myself as the guinea pig, if you will.
I was going to ask, John, is some portion of your wall devoted to your own interpretations?
Oh, it's unavoidable. It is unavoidable if one has a mind that is conditioned in one particular corner of the world to see things in a certain way. There's no doubt that I will taint it, the prophecy. The difference that I propose to your listeners is that my study and practice of meditation probably makes me better able to take a step back from my own prophetic biases and examine them as well as the interpretation.
On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning. Where are you calling from, please?
Good morning. I'm calling from Lake Elsinore, California. Two real quick questions. I read a prophecy of Nostradamus where he says that on July 7th, 1999, his prophecy will be fulfilled. I like your comment on that. I've also read a prophecy. It's called the Prophecy of Malachi, in which he states that the last pope is going to be Peter II when all of the Antichrist tribulation stuff happens. And I'd like your comment on both of those things.
All right. The end of prophecy in 99, John.
Yes, that's quatrain 72, I believe, of century 10. And it's actually 1999 and 7 months. So it's July of 1999. And it's a pretty horrific warning. Basically, the great king of terror descends from the sky, and they will resurrect the king of the Mongols. I looked at that. The final line is, before and after, Mars rules happily. Or it can be interpreted, before and after, war rules happily. Problem with the key. First about the great king of the Mongols. Now, that's Genghis Khan. And I wondered, well, is this a riddle, or is this literal, or is this poetic, or is this one of his clues to dating the time of when to start looking for this difficult window that ends in 1999?
Yes.
I did find out that in the end of the 80s, after Tiananmen Square massacre, the old leaders of China rehabilitated Genghis Khan in Chinese school books, put him back in and made him as a noble model of all that was good in being a tyrant. So in a way, bringing back to life Genghis Khan does not have to mean that actually a reincarnation of Genghis Khan or a Eastern leader, but simply it's already happened. So 1989 would be the one end of the window that ends with the other end in 1999. Now, there's a hopeful clue inside this prophecy, and that is the link is Mars. Now, most interpreters of Nostradamus, I would criticize them for not looking at the occult significance of the application of words in his prophecies. The man was a mystic and an occult scientist. You know, Mars is everything in the occult has two aspects, one negative and one positive. Now, Mars can be quite negative if it's the god of war. That's the lower vibratory potentials of the planet in astrology. In the higher forms, it is Mars, the magus, the magician, the one who holds the rod of Hermes, which is the rod of a religious point of view that sees as above, so below, all is divine. It is almost a comparable to the tantric point of view in the East, that all is divine. So how can you divide the world into black and white?
Yes.
You embrace the world as one divine thing of either lower energies or higher energies in the play of the divine. So that's the Hermetic point of view. So before and after Mars rules, in fact, that was even something David McCallum said so well in his Shakespearean style in Ancient Prophecies Part 1, Mars rules. You know, well, and what they didn't do in the show is, which is one of the few criticisms I have of the show, is that they don't really spend enough time giving you both sides of the prophetic angle.
Unfortunately.
I will predict for you that will probably, this doomsday theme of Friday's show will probably be much doomier and gloomier than I would like them to portray. Hopefully, if we do more and more of these shows, they'll run out of dark things to say and give me a chance to talk about all the alternatives.
Are you at all familiar, while we've mentioned Mars, with the work of Richard Hoagland with regard to the new geometry and the phase on Mars and the newer revelations and the photographs of the structures on the moon?
I think I have his most recent picture book on that,
the
Martian Faces. I remember when that first was seen years and years ago. I will only know, hopefully in our lifetime, we'll find out whether it was just one of those funny freaks of fate that the Mars probe just had an accident and shut off, or whether it was shut off. Certainly, if those images are proven to be humanoid made or by intelligent life. Can you imagine anything that would overnight topple, shift the axis of political and religious opinion as significantly as all the prophecies about the Earth axis shifting.
Oh, you brought it together perfectly. No, I certainly couldn't, and maybe it is the event.
And in fact, I contend in the Millennium Book of Prophecy that there's two ways of looking at all the shift of the Earth's axis prophecies. Either it's a shift, physical shift of the Earth by 40 degrees, as Ruth Montgomery's spirit guides seem to indicate, or it is a shift in consciousness. And certainly, I think we're a few years away from having some understanding that there is intelligent life out there that no one can deny. I would almost say that we've been slowly prepared for it for the last 50 years, and to where when it does finally happen, we'll almost take it for granted, and that there's intelligent life out there. But in another aspect, it's, Arthur C. Clarke said it best in one of his sequels to 2001, I think 2060 or something, where he said when they discovered that there was life on Jupiter in his fictional story, overnight a lot of the people solved their differences on national levels and became a global body. The UN overnight became the law of the Earth.
Yes.
Simply because now there's someone out there that we have to deal with.
A lot of people fear that right now. A lot of talk about it on talk shows. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning. Where are you calling from, please?
Good morning, gentlemen. This is Vinny in Wichita.
Hi, Vinny.
Mr. Hogue, just touching on what I was going to ask about, if there's any prophecy in Nostradamus concerning UFO abductions and contact with the intelligence of an extraterrestrial origin. I'll hang up and listen.
All right, thank you. That's a really good one.
Vinny, I'm trying right now in my study of the etymology of all the words to look at all the possible angles to the old French word étranger, which is étranger in modern French, and see if foreigner, alien, whatever, can be applied in those futuristic terms. At this moment in my study, I would not say that there is something that stands up and screams in my face saying it's about extraterrestrial events. There are, of course, in other traditions of prophecy, a lot of indications of that. And in my next book on the collective prophecy theme, I'm going to deal with that. But in Nostradamus, it's a little obscure. But we'll see. Maybe when on the third book, when I've done this reexamination of all the usages of words, I might come up with some interpretations in that matter.
John, are you familiar with a rather obscure document called the Pope's Predictions?
Well, this is concerning the St. Malachi predictions?
Well, this is a document that purports to have been from the diary of a pope. I can't recall just which one. I'm sorry, I've got it here somewhere.
I'm aware of it.
That came from a Philippine newspaper. Which predicts events in 1995. And if you have not seen it or heard of it, I'll try and get you a copy.
Oh, that'd be great. Usually there's so much of a wealth of prophecies out there, and then I have to go through a process where once I get it, then I have to verify where it's really from.
Of course.
Sure. Yeah.
Of course. All right, well, let's go back to the phone. A lot of people on here.
Okay.
On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Where are you calling from, please?
Evans, Colorado.
All right, go ahead.
Good evening, guys. Just a couple points here real quick. Your guest seems to be suffering from a syndrome I've noticed among certain people who'd like to deny the truth of the Bible. They'll try and say that it's all a lie or that...
I didn't say that.
Well,
what are you suffering from?
Well, he's suffering from a terminal narrow-mindedness, in my opinion, but
okay,
that's just
okay.
My opinion.
I'll just move on then. You said something about how we're going to have to reduce population. Do you believe in population control?
All right, thank you. That's a good straight-out question.
Yes. That's a good straight answer.
That would be the exact answer that I would give him, too. And he would argue long and hard against it, as would the Vatican. On the wild card line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning. Hello there. Going once, going twice, going three times. On the second wildcard line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hello.
Oh, hi. This is Pat from Boise, KIDO territory.
Boise, Idaho, yes.
Right. I'm going to bring it down to a more earthly level. What does Nostradamus have to say about the ring of fire and specifically the Cascades, and just saw a program on the Discovery Channel tonight about a lot of new faults discovered under Los Angeles and the Northridge quake, putting a lot of pressure on those faults.
All right.
Well, nothing specifically about the Ring of Fire. That's the ring of volcanoes that rings the entire Pacific coast of Asia, Australasia, and North and South
frequent,
America.
Frequent geologic movement.
Now, there's a lot more said in Edgar Cayce and other prophets than Nostradamus. Certainly, there is one obscure prophecy that has a clear, in most people's interpretation, contemporary story, but it doesn't mention the city except that it's called the New City, and it only mentions the time in May that would happen, this earthquake, but it does not mention the year, as far as I can see so far in looking at it. And because of that prophecy, almost every May in L.A., there's a hysteria about, oh, this is the May of the big one. You have a lot of people crying wolf about it. I would only say that, getting back to what you said earlier about the physical phenomenon, that the alignment of planets merging behind the sun and pulling away from Earth's orbit in May of 2000 certainly will cause a lot of solar flare activity, will cause a lot of gravitational pull. And I mean, it's not, this is, let's make this clear, this is not a clairvoyant prediction. It's simply looking at the phenomenon around that. That seems to me to be one of the best windows for an earthquake happening on the San Andreas Fault of that magnitude.
A good time to go visit the friends in the Midwest somewhere.
Yes, but I hope that my interpretation is dreadful only in that it's dreadfully wrong.
All right. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Where are you calling from, please?
Memphis.
Memphis, Tennessee. All right.
I had a question about a quatrain that Memphis is, well, the term Memphis is in it. I don't know which Memphis, but it talks about the great Hercules, the great Mercury of Hercules. It and it mentions the words fleur-de-lis. The roads will be greatly improved. I do not have the century and number,
yeah,
but I wondered if you remembered it.
Not offhand. There's over 1,000 of them. But I do remember the reference to Memphis, and so far I think it's probably one of Nostradamus' classical allusions to modern Egypt rather than Memphis on the Mississippi.
Sounds like you're safe.
Well, thank you.
Thank you very much for the call. I suppose anything, any word or city name in modern day uttered by Nostradamus is going to be a cause for worry.
Yes. Yes. I would say that the difficulty with Nostradamus is that he has created clearly and consciously a very obscure device. He's done that to keep the controversy of his prophecies going for centuries. And I would say that
it's worked.
It's worked, and ultimately it can be, if used rightly, what we're really talking about here is, for the last few hours, is how we affect the future today. And the controversy of future is you know, without Nostradamus, we wouldn't be thinking about it so much in the last few centuries.
On the toll-free line, your turn with John Hogue. Good morning. Where are you, please?
Well, this is Tom in Kansas City.
Yes, Tom.
John, I'd like to know, did Nostradamus predict any good news for our future? Secondly, did he predict when the Antichrist would come into power, and if so, what would life be like under his rule?
All right.
I'll hang up and listen on the air.
All right, thank you. From Kansas City. Good news?
Well, yes, there is. If we get through this next difficult period, something of a messianic nature will take place starting in the year 2002 and usher in a millennium of peace. In 1,000 years from that time, mankind will kind of go to sleep again, get unconscious again. And then there's a very catastrophic change for Earth in the year 3797. Basically, it's destroyed by fire. However, in his distant prophecies, he talks about man, the races of man will long ago left Earth and will be living in Cancer and for a longer time in Aquarius. Now, the way I look at the old French is that you can't live in a constellation unless you are living in the world of a constellation.
All right, John, we've got to hold it there. We're at the top of the hour. We'll hold the question with regard to life under the Antichrist until after we come back, all right?
Okay.
All right. Very good. John Hoag is my guest. What an honor to have him here.
This is Premier Networks. That was Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM on this Somewhere in Time. Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
I predict John Hoag will be with us all 5 hours. Really went out on a limb on that one.
Somewhere in Time with Art Bell continues, courtesy of Premier Networks.
John, are you there?
Yep.
Good. You're really up for one more hour, huh?
Oh, yes. Your prophecy will be fulfilled.
I want a spot on your wall.
Well, I just have a prophecy to add to your gold prophecy. It's from Hermes Trismegistus from, hard to say at this hour, at 1st century A.D., when he said, "Fortunate is the man who knows how to read the signs of the times, for that man shall escape many misfortunes, or at least be prepared to understand the blow."
I love it. All right, on the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hoag. Hello there. Hello there on the toll-free line. Going once, going twice, gone. On the wild card line, it's your turn with John Hoag. Good morning.
Yes, this is Sunshine. And may I hang, Art, because we lose you this hour. So hear his response?
I'm sorry?
Okay.
What is your question? What is your question?
Thanks. I have a couple of things, John. Were you aware of that cloth train that they put in one of those yellow rag sheets about O.J.?
Yes, I'm trying to get a copy of it. I don't think it holds much weight. But,
I wondered if it was.
I mean, I get that question a lot. Did O.J. do it? Well, I think at least my study of prophecy is focused on more matters that affect us all personally, like the movements of leaders, of political and religious changes and earth changes.
Is it somehow bad karma to use prophecy for lesser things?
I might be able to answer by an example. I mean, there's what often happens to great visionaries of prophets is that they sometimes, when they've made truly successful and authentic predictions, there's a temptation for them to get into the gin mill of spinning out predictions by the dozen for a lot of tabloidal papers. I used to keep for years a log of the New Year's predictions for each year of the National Enquirer, and then check to see if any of them came true. And I mean the sequence of accuracy was just pure chance. If anything happened, it seemed very few ever were fulfilled. And one of the people who I feel is truly authentic, who's kind of fallen for that rut, is Jean Dixon. And I mean, she definitely authentically predicted many remarkable things. But in 1988, the end of 88, she made a whole bunch of predictions for 89, And almost all of them proved to be dreadfully wrong, except for one that was quite right. She said that the Berlin Wall would be sold as souvenirs.
No, no, no kidding.
So she still got it sometimes. She still got it. But, I haven't had time in the publicity to actually look and see if there's any correlation. I mean, I will look. I look at anything crazy or not and see if it has some application. Certainly, my own rules of interpreting Nostradamus, because the trial has become such a public collective thing, I will have to take a more serious examination of the quatrain, see if it's anything that indicates O.J. Simpson or what have you.
One has to wonder if you actually go looking for something like that with the volume of the quatrains, if you're not almost sure to find something.
Well, this is another aspect of my work, which I start with this second book in Nostradamus, is the fanaticism of interpretation.
Yes.
Or disinterpretation. The blind believers who will just pull out anything. I mean, there's some books out now that are a new low in Nostradamus' interpretation. They're making all kinds of wild claims that are just dreadfully wrong. And it's amazing how the claims always come out about a year after publication, so they get some profit from their prophecy before the books are all on receivership shelves because they're just so dreadful. But the other side of the coin of fanaticism is the blind debunker, the people who will come into the subject of Nostradamus with their conclusions already made and then just try to find bits and pieces here that they can cram up their own conclusions.
The Phil Klass of predictions.
Or the James Randi of...
James Randi.
Yeah.
I've got four very fast questions here, and I'd like fast answers if we can get them. One, this comes by facts. Have a few questions on different areas of interest. One, are there any predictions about the fall of the English monarchy?
Well, there are some that could be applied to it. A change of reign has come up a few times. I've even commented on it in the previous book. However, it is pretty obscure. It could be a change of the reign of centuries, the reign of many things. So there again, there are many Nostradamus quatrains that really expose the interpreter and the interpretation rather than actually clarify a future event.
There have been very recent difficulties, as you know, for the monarchy.
Oh, yes.
All right, well, let's keep moving. I've got four of them. Two, I once read in a Nostradamus book of the total destruction of New York City, which I believe was called New World City. Do you still see this?
Well, it's based on the Garden of the World, which has been interpreted since the mid-40s to be the Garden State, right? Kind of the old law of Nostradamus that you pick something nearby the real event when you really want to talk about New York or the new city. And again, the prophecies dealing with an earthquake or natural disasters hitting the new city could also apply to New York. He also might have described it as the Hollow Mountains.
Or the Garden State, New Jersey.
Yeah, right. And also the fact that, the potential of the quatrain numbering of 97 could mean 1997 as a window around that time. But New City could also apply. The latitude 45 is where the city is supposed to be. And when I look at a good map of the world, there's only one major city that even comes close to exactly being under latitude 45, and that's Belgrade in Serbia. And in fact, the northern new suburb, Novi Belgrade, New Belgrade, New City, if you like, is even closer. So I threw out in the new revelations a new interpretation saying, all New York City interpretations aside, maybe it's talking about Belgrade.
Maybe it is. Do you believe that within the next year, this world will turn on its axis, causing massive changes?
The period of time, if you look at Edgar Cayce's plotting of it, as well as Nostradamus, it would seem that 98, 99 through 2000, 2001, if you look at the pyramid prophecies, Chaldean time cycle, that's your window. Between 2001 and 1998 is your window for this. Now, I wouldn't have said this 10 years ago, but I feel more inclined to think that it is a shift in perspective, in paradigm, rather than a shift in the axis.
All right, and finally, this is from LS in Southern California. The last question, if you were me, would you move out of Southern California soon?
Well, that's, if I were to answer that, I would be taking on the responsibility, many responsibilities. I would be presuming that you're not there. How to put this? This is a loaded question.
Well, you've already answered it.
Yeah, it's
without,
not my place to tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. My place is to provide you data, and it's your place to make your decisions in your life.
Mm-hmm. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning.
Well, good morning, gentlemen.
Hello.
Good morning.
John, what's your prediction on this new Republican bill that's circulating that says this? Young mothers, 18 years old and younger, are going to have their welfare cut off. Then, if they cannot support that child, their child is going to be put in an orphanage.
All right, let me translate that very direct political slam, as best he could get it in, into a wider question, John. There is certainly a move toward a much more conservative atmosphere in America. I mean, the changing the House, the Senate, the whole thing, the whole business is changing, and our direction is changing. What do you make out of this?
Very simple. We've weathered through the extreme left of the Johnson years, and we're swinging to extreme right. What's basically happening is this is a symptom of the collective anger in the world. And people made a very angry collective vote, and the problem with anger is I'm not saying I'm for or against it. I'm just simply stating the suchness of anger is that it often, when a gesture is done in anger, it tends to polarize rather than unite. The thing that I see is that there's a very great opportunity for American politicians in the next 2 years. I think the message, as far as I would look at it as a prophetic scholar, is American people want it to work, so they want people to find consensus and bipartisanship in the general sense. And when I felt that, I was kind of vindicated by the recent poll. Over 62% of people want the government to work. They don't want it to be seen as a pro-Republican right-wing idea. They just want the Congress and the president to work together to make the government work. And
So, John, do you predict that the Republicans will blow it? In other words, they will take this mandate to mean let's go for a good hard shift to the right instead of let's govern in the center.
Yes, I do. Unfortunately, I would like to be optimistic and think that they will follow more Bob Dole's point of view about that contract, but I think Newt's point of view is going to win out, and an extreme elements of the party are going to have a very divisive, maybe even split the Republican Party. It would be unfortunate. I would love to see that there be a balance, but I think what will come out of the next 2 years is the American people will neither be extreme right or extreme left. They will see the real revolution lies within being in the center.
Oh, great. All right, on the wild card line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hello.
Hello, calling from St. Louis, KSD.
Yes, sir.
Just one question. I wonder if we can get John's telephone number again.
yeah, you bet we can. John, tell them about your books and give the individual numbers once again, if you would, please.
Okay, the Millennium Book of Prophecy, for this book, it is 1-800-331-3761. And then for the Nostradamus, the New Revelations, it is 1-800-253-6476.
And you told me which of the books is it? The first one that's selling, you said, just like crazy.
Well, this is actually happening with both books. It's like the poor printers can't keep up with it. As soon as they get into the bookstores, they go. So, if you don't find it in your bookstore, the other thing you do is just order, have them there on the computers.
You can go down to B. Dalton or whatever, and
any bookstore that has a computer access to any warehouse of books, and you can back order them. They're rushing as fast as they can to keep them in print in the bookstores, that is. But if you follow the 1-800 number, you're sure to get one on order.
All right, good. You have not seen the television program you're going to be on this Friday, correct?
Correct.
Do you watch it? Do you want to watch it, or are you sitting on pins, sitting there if you do watch it? I'm curious.
Well, I'm always concerned, as we talk about TV, is the realm of the soundbite, and I mean of the basically of a little bite of information.
Well, it is, yes.
And the difficulty is that in the last Ancient Prophecies I did, I was filmed for several hours talking about things, and I, like on this show, I do the half empty or half full device.
Yeah, I'm sure you thought, God, I got a lot of really great stuff in.
And mostly because of time constraints and the theme, it was almost all the pessimistic prophecies. So I want to warn everybody that I think you ought to watch it, but don't be too surprised if you only hear mostly all my negative points of view about things. Just understand that everything I say that's negative on that show, I've also countered with a positive alternative. And I am lobbying very hard in Ancient Prophecies 4 and 5 that'll come out next year to have them finally exhaust the negative doomsday and look at what I like to call as bloomsday.
You understand why they're doing what they're doing, of course.
Oh, yeah, the problem with television, I mean, I understand, it's the nature of the beast. It's sensationalism comes before understanding.
Yes.
But the show is doing very well. It's creating a lot of interest. It's almost becoming a mini-series when it was only supposed to be just a one-time deal. I'm hopeful, and I want to help them as much as I can to really fill all the dimensions of the prophetic situation of the genre.
Well, maybe they'll make, John, a slow transition, dropping a little bit in here and a little bit in there, and they will decide, my goodness, this seems to sell too,
yeah.
And you'll open them up in that way.
Yes, I mean, in a way, it's been an uphill battle, even with Millennium Book of Prophecy. I mean, I've probably got one of the most terrifying examinations of Doomsday, but I have 350 pages of alternatives. I don't think there are many books, if any books out there at this moment, that try so exhaustively with hundreds of prophecies to show that there is creative alternatives to the future. They've been there,
well,
working in the prophecy business for centuries, but because of the mindset, most people are fixated on the negative.
Well, but I'm no different than they are. You've mentioned several times now this most terrifying version of Doomsday. Mm. What is it?
Well, simply, what I've done in the book is I've updated the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse and changed the allegory to the four Hell Riders of Doomsday, and I've updated it. The first Hell, basically what I've done is taken groups of Doomsday predictions into four dimensions in this cycle. The trailblazer is overpopulation. Basically, she's the human breeding urge run amok.
Mm.
And she's the trailblazer, because almost all the problems that can lead to a third world war are based on too many mouths to feed, too many thirsts to quench. And she is followed by Earth trauma. And I have very beautiful illustrations made by an artist in Australia for each one of these in full color. And she is, Earth trauma is the harbinger of doomsday through ecological breakdown of Earth's climate and food chains. Now, the third Hell Rider is the Lemming Syndrome, and that is the harbinger of plagues. He's basically the stress of modern living breaking down man's immune system and his will to live.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the fourth and final Hell Rider is, I have him looking like a terrorist with a halo made of the nuclear symbol, and he's got a little happy face button on his shoulder, and basically he is the Third World's War. Rather than the Third World War, he's the Third World's War. It is a future nuclear holocaust that may be more possible now because the Cold War has ended.
Well, all I can say is, John, thank God none of that seems to be happening, huh?
Well, I often say with the book, when they ask, well, what do you think will happen with this book 10 years later? I said, I hope we're sitting here 10 years from now, and the first half of the book will read like fiction from a Stephen King novel.
It
never happened.
All right,
and
John.
The last half will read like, hey, that really did happen.
Yeah, John, all right, hold on a moment. We'll be right back to you. I was being as facetious as I could be. I know you look at it positively, but I'm afraid I see the glass about half empty. And most of the four you just mentioned I would actually see as in progress. We'll be back.
This is Premier Networks. That was Art Bell hosting Coast to Coast AM on this Somewhere in Time. Take you back to the past on Art Bell Somewhere in Time.
John Hogue, the world's foremost expert on Nostradamus, is my guest and has been my guest for the last 4.5 hours. We've got about 25 more minutes to do of one of the better shows we've had in a long time, I think.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from November 15th, 1994.
All right, John, here we go. Hi, John. All the prophecies about Mount Rainier and earthquakes aside, I would like to know your spin on the UN's recent interest in the Northwest, that park they're talking about, and all the new UFO activity. What is the relationship, if any? There's been a lot of supernatural phenomenon as well. Any comments?
Well, you know, this is the land of Twin Peaks.
It sure is.
And right now we're having quite a leaden sky with Tom Robbins, who's an expatriate of the South, who lives up here, says thousands of little water guppies battering themselves against window panes. A lot of rain up here. But to answer your question, well, there's a lot of UFO activity up here. I mean, this is the area where the term flying saucer was created. I often joke to my friends that it must be because of our space needle looking like a flying saucer on a stand, you know, like saying, welcome, folks. But just kidding aside, the doorway to the Pacific Rim is going to be Seattle. I think it's very significant that APEC was held here.
Yes.
And it's definitely going to be the window. It's closer to Asia than any other major city on the American West Coast and by the curvature of the Earth. So Seattle
You don't anticipate it becoming even closer yet, do you?
Well, it's ambiguous. It's a little ambiguous. Now, maybe it's ambiguous because I live here. That's my prophetic bias. But my feeling is more towards the, if there's seismic activity, it's in relationship to Rainier or one of the big volcanoes up here having an episode. I would be more concerned if I lived in Tacoma.
I don't suppose you would consider that to be the great final honor, that is to say, a prophet's final moment going up in his own prophecy?
Well, it would serve me right. It would be the final honor to my prejudice.
And would no doubt,
if that were to happen to me.
And would no doubt grant the wish of a number of callers this morning as well.
Well, I always feel like I make a million friends and a million enemies in every show.
I'm sure you do. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hello.
Hello, Art Bell?
Yes, uh-huh.
Just a second, can turn my radio off.
Oh, that's good. Everybody do that as soon as you get on the air. Where are you calling from, sir?
Santa Rosa, California.
All right, KSRO.
Well, I got a few questions.
Well, go ahead.
Okay, one thing that hasn't been real clear in the program so far is why Nostradamus?
Why Nostradamus?
Yes.
Well, I don't know if that's in your category to answer or not, John, is it?
Well, it's like, why not? And upon what do you base that statement? Have you studied Nostradamus?
He has a lot of prophecies, but what is the validity of his prophecies? What's his track record?
Well, we've been documenting that all evening long. How much of the program have you heard, sir?
The whole program.
The whole program. Well, then you've no doubt heard the long chain of, or perhaps you didn't in the first hour, I don't know, but the long chain of predictions that indeed have been accurate with great detail.
Well, this is exactly the point I wanted to bring up again, just for the listeners. The other point is exactly why prophecy?
What
does a prophet's role in society play?
Okay, well, that's a little better. I was going to say your questions are very consistent. Why prophecy, John?
Well, there's two ways to use prophecy, either to obsess on tomorrow and kind of avoid the ability to respond, the responsibility of today, or to use prophecy like you use science fiction, like you use futurology, or any other speculative look at tomorrow as a reflection of where you're going today.
Oh, that's a good answer. On the first-time caller line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hi. Hello there.
Hello.
Yes, sir, you're on the air.
I was wondering, what about what Lindsay Williams said the other day about the diseases taking over the inner cities?
Yes, all right. That actually is a good road to go down. John, diseases, we had Lindsay Williams on. He was talking about a lot of diseases, and indeed, AIDS... Not just AIDS, lots of other diseases. The CDC making predictions of diseases we've never seen before. Penicillin now not so effective against diseases.
Or antibiotics.
Yes, sir.
Yes, well, I have a whole. That's what the whole chapter of the Lemming Syndrome is about. It's a reexamination of the seven final plagues of the Book of Revelation, and it's St. John the Divine's predictions backed up by other prophetic traditions of other religions, and which actually are a little clearer in some respects to what he's saying. But basically, looking at the seven final plagues, and the argument I posed, my interpretation of them is that in some degree all seven of those plagues are with us today as another symptom of the old dying and to replace pave the way for a new cycle of centuries, a new history of mankind, or humanity, as I like to call it. And, of course, the seven final plagues deal with the immune deficiency diseases, with crowding, with stress, with pollution, and eventually get more subtle with mindset, you know, the opiate of false prophets. That again, returning to the controversial interpretation I have that what is Antichrist is the rigid orthodoxy of current religions rather than a person. And finally,
must want some more of those calls, huh, John?
Yeah, well, it's the hazard of my profession.
No doubt. All right, here is a call on the wild card line. You're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning.
Yes, sir.
You have to speak up. We can barely hear you.
You were talking about near-death experiences?
Yes, uh-huh.
And my first one, I was told I would have to die three times and come through the fire. And during that time, with all the suffering, I'd become more spiritual and progressed. But what I try to do is put a stop to the hate that's going on, because I think that's the only thing that can stop what everybody, because I think everybody is trying to fulfill this prediction of the earth and everything coming to the end.
Yes, that's exactly what we've been talking about, and
it's a great point. I mean, it's something I'd like to say is that there's something more terrifying to people than doomsday. It's the personal responsibility to counter it.
Hmm.
I think that in some people might find the second half of my book, which is all very detailed alternatives, somewhat on a subtle level, more frightening than the old familiar doomsday. I mean, we all know how it'll end if we follow the track into the ditch, you know. But what if we don't go into that ditch? Then it's very ambiguous. Then it's like, my God, we really have to create a new world. That millennium of peace won't happen unless we create it. And that's going to be a great challenge, much more challenging in a way than fighting war at Armageddon.
But on the other hand, if you look down the strand of time, John, if you can look ahead in time, there's always going to be a door off to the side that would lead to destruction.
Okay.
And while we might not walk through that door today or tomorrow or even in the year 2000, what are the odds that we can go down this strand of time forever without finally walking through that damn door?
Well, you know, in the question I sense there's always death and rebirth, and there are cycles. There are golden ages and dark ages, and we're at pretty much the bottom now of a dark age, and we're going to start rising out of it in the next few centuries. According to the Indian mystic Mirababa, by 700 years from now, we will be the whole world will be an enlightened paradise. It'll peak then, 700 years from now, and then it'll, you know, we take for granted the enlightenment, we take for granted how beautiful it is, and then naturally you start sinking into another cycle and go into the dark, and it seems that this is the way it is here in this certain plane of existence. It seems to be a classroom that goes up and down.
But see, at the bottom of each one of those cycles you're talking about, I see one of those doors.
Oh, yes. Oh, absolutely. I mean, there is a choice for extinction or to continue. Definitely. It's almost like if it's a person who's like kind of the Peter Pan syndrome. You know, the human race is like a person, can be described as a person who's never really wanted to grow up and now is facing the issues of adulthood and on some level reaches a crisis where they either go, I'm going to commit suicide or I'm going to grow up and deal with my problems. And I think on the collective level, the human race is really looking like that Peter Pan going, well, you know, I could always be divided against myself and fight my little wars and abuse the earth, but now I've become so big on this planet and that the world has become small in comparison to my bigness and my power, and now I'm poised to destroy myself if I just keep going down the road I've been going. And we may destroy civilization. That is an option. But I think it's going to be a personal choice of each human being on the planet to say, well, do I want to say yes to change and growing, or do I want to hold on to stuff that's fossilized about my life?
Right. On the first-time caller line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Mike from Milwaukee, Oregon.
Hello, Mike.
Yes, Jesus Christ said he was the way, the truth, and the life. And
so is Muhammad.
That's a narrow way. And, well, you can call, you know, you call Jesus Christ, I don't know what her name he said he was called by, but he did say that.
Well, as
so did Buddha, so did Muhammad, so did Krishna.
Well, the devil is a liar, and he takes many forms.
Well, how convenient.
Broad is the road to destruction, and narrow is the way to life. That's what the Bible says.
Okay, but the Hindu priest, with as much sincerity as you, has said exactly the same thing about your side of your point of view, and Muslims have the same about the other, and vice versa, and all this name-calling, condemning in the name of God is given as about 5,000 wars in the last 3,000 years. Is this something we can continue with?
So much anger. There's so much anger out there, isn't there?
Yeah, because people are afraid. Anger is in a kind of an assertive, my experience of anger is that it's an assertive form of fear. Fear of the unknown, fear of change. People are scared out there.
I can't blame them for that.
No, I can't either.
On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hi.
Yes, good morning from Spanaway. How are you today, sir?
Just fine.
Yes, I'd like to say accolades to you and your guest, John, for mentioning the specifics regarding population control. I've been in favor of that for longer than I can remember. And I'd like to thank you both for making that point clear and bringing it to the public eye once again.
Well, I've always believed it. It sounds like John has too, and it sounds like it's center in most prophecy. So.
I believe that, speaking of civilization, whether we can preserve it or bury it, I believe that the fulcrum here, the centerpiece, if you will, that will determine our survival will be whether or not we can bring the population under control. And I feel that if we can't, perhaps the damage is irreparable already, but On the hope that we can, I would say fine, but the way things are headed now, given the global population count, I do not see too much hope for the 21st century, personal viewpoint.
Well, I share it, but we've got an eternal optimist here, John Hogue, and you really are an eternal optimist now, aren't you?
Pretty much.
Hang on to it, John.
Yep. Well, I would say about the situation is, I think it will get much worse before people in a mainstream sense will understand that we are on a war against our fossilized beliefs. This is really the Third World War that I personally would like to wage. Not a war against people, a war against ideas, but a war against my own stupidity and the collective stupidity of man. That's the real enemy. And hopefully the good that can come out of the curse of things getting far worse in the next few years, because they will, is that people on all levels of life won't need to listen to some fringy fellow talking about prophecy and his books or stuff like that. We'll just see it in their present, that this doomsday is happening and we don't have to have it happen. It'll be really a choice over life or death. And the darker it gets could actually help it to get lighter later.
That's a good way to put it. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hi.
Hi. My name's Scott. I'm calling from Portland.
Yes, Scott.
I hope this question's relevant. It seems like it might be in the field of John's expertise. I was wondering if there were any similar instances of Christ's resurrection by other messiahs in your vast reading of ancient religious texts.
Interesting question.
Yes, there are, and also there are many virgin births. Quetzalcoatl, the Messiah of the Indians, the Red Indians, was also born of a virgin. So Jesus's particular special role in the history of gynecology is not singular, but plural.
Remarkable. On the toll-free line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Hello.
Hi, Art. This is Tom from Seattle.
Hello, Tom.
Hi. I had a comment and a question. As far as the narrow way of Christianity, I think that was meant entirely spiritual and not theological. And I share your objection to the dogmatism of that. And a question I had for you, John, assuming the life and death cycle of humanity is analogous to sleeping and waking.
Put in a word.
Pardon me?
In other words, I think we're asleep now.
Yeah. Assuming mankind is physically extinct, what might happen to the souls that could not reincarnate?
All right.
Well, in a way, there's a lot of theories about this, and let's specify these are theories. I would say voice that one of the theories is that they may have to move to other worlds more suitable to their state of awareness or sleepiness and incarnate there. That's one theory that's proffered in mystical circles. I'm not saying I believe or disbelieve in that. I mean, certainly one can see a judgment day of sorts is coming, just as one could say that it's the judgment day of water that at 100 degrees it boils, or the judgment day of paper that it, when it gets as hot as 451 degrees it burns.
Yes.
The 6 billion people on the planet, enough CFCs to punch holes in the ozone, and all these things could be like that old straw that breaks the camel's back, as it were. Somebody could sit back and say, that's Judgment Day, and you don't actually need a god, a personification of the divine, to say, okay, we're going to bury this right now. It's our own actions.
Suicide, then.
It's a suicide out of fear of change, or fear of growing up.
All right, well, we've got very little time left. On the wildcard line, you're on the air with John Hogue. Good morning.
Good morning, Arch. Calling from KEX, Portland.
Yes, sir.
Great guest. John, my question to you is, I've listened to most of the broadcast, and some of you're obviously outstanding in your comprehension, your expertise in the area, and I've read all of Nostradamus's quatrains and understand hardly any of them, but some of them are quite interesting. my question to you is, and I'm kind of basing this on a few things you said about current politics near political happenings. How much do you feel you can separate your personal emotions from your prescience?
Well, this is the issue that in my work I always try to pose to people. I always think it's a shame that few scholars or more scholars don't say, in my opinion, in my interpretation. I mean, I like to take responsibility for my interpretations. And in the beginning of the book, Millennium Book of Prophecy, I did say, I do say a note to the reader that you got to, you know, take my interpretation as and see if it resonates with you. And to remember that I'm just another judging, self-righteous human being trying to sleepwalk into awareness. And that I have something to share, and if it resonates with you and it works for you, good. If it doesn't, drop it like a bad habit.
Very well put, and thank you very much.
Thank you. And unfortunately, we're about out of time. John, a lot of what you've said this morning has resonated with me. I don't know that it's resonated in the way you've wanted it to, but most of what you have quoted sort of on the negative side before just then turning positive in your way, the negative side of it, of course, has resonated with me, and I don't see the upturn, the uptick, the pulling out of the bottom. To me, we're still at the bottom, or it's even going to get worse, and I see bad signs all around me, socially, economically.
I do too. It's going to get worse,
you know,
before it gets better, but it will turn. But it could get worse all the way through till 2012.
All right, look, we're utterly out of time. We could do hours and hours, but we can't. John, boy, what a trooper you've been. John, we'll do it again sometime. I guarantee it's been fabulous.
It's been a great show, Art. Love to be on anytime you need me.
Thank you, John.
Yeah.
Take care. John Hogue, who can be seen, I might add, this coming Friday evening at 8 o'clock, we believe. Check your local listings. The program name is Ancient Prophecies. John Hogue will be featured prominently. That's it, I'm afraid. Thank you all from the high desert. Good night.